Folks, welcome. It's Raj Dulari from Longview, and I wanted to thank you for joining our webinar today. This is Extending Healthcare with Microsoft Teams, and we're very glad that you've taken this time to join us. What I'd like to point out is we are Longview, and Longview is an organization based out of Calgary, but we have offices across Canada, and we have about 1,200 employees here in Canada focused in on technology and really working with companies to help them secure their assets both on-site and also in the cloud. And we really work with customers to help them plan and secure their IT environments both on-premise and in the cloud. I want to point out that I think all of us know that our world's changed pretty dramatically in the last several months. What used to be a would like with collaborative technology is really now a necessity. And in the past, we would look at collaborative technologies and from a healthcare perspective and think of them only in the context of telehealth. Today, that's not the case. So many hospital systems in Canada and the US have actively applied collaborative technologies to extend care. And what's really interesting is they want to take it forward once COVID is a memory and start applying those learnings to building capacity and making care more accessible. And really what we're going to talk to you today about is how you can extend care by using Microsoft Teams. With that in mind, before I get into too much detail, I would like to talk about some housekeeping. If you have questions, please enter them in the question box, and we will get to them at the end of the webinar. If it turns out that we have too many questions to answer, what we will do is we will be sure to reply to them via email. So if you could leave your email address, that would be just great, and we'll get back to you if you have a question. Our presentation today is going to be led by Shane Weber. Shane Weber is an industry expert with collaborative technologies, and he's a longstanding Longview employee with 7 years tenure, but about 20 years experience in the industry, specifically in the end user and modern workplace area. Shane is part of our leadership team at Longview, and he's considered an industry expert in the area of collaborative technologies and has been asked to chair and participate in many industry forums on this subject. So I'm very pleased to have Shane here, and Shane is going to be leading this discussion. So Shane, without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you, Raj, and good afternoon, good morning, good evening to some of you. So really excited to be here today. As Raj said, we're here to talk about extending healthcare with Microsoft Teams. It's not just extending healthcare, but it's also opening the doorway to modernizing healthcare, and not just within our facilities, not just telehealth, but really we're going to show today kind of art of the possible, what you can do with Microsoft Teams. And I'm going to help you understand that it's more than just a hub for teamwork in your organization, unified collaborations and communication. I want to make sure that everybody understands this is a presentation layer and a hub for all things to be productive on behalf of your organization, or to interact with your customers, your partners, other organizations in a way you couldn't before. So Raj did a bit of housekeeping. I just want to talk about a brief agenda. It's just brief, and then we're going to drive through this. I want to make sure everybody understands. I like to keep this immersive and interactive, so I will bounce from screen to screen. I'll take you through some immersive interactions in the Teams client to really help people understand some of what it looks and feels like. I'm going to show a couple brief videos to really immerse you in what's going on in healthcare from a Microsoft Teams perspective and art of the possible, and give you some really good context around the things we're going to talk about today. And without further ado, I want to make sure everybody understands. Please ask questions throughout. Post those questions, like Raj said, in the chat window. I'll make sure that I pause at times throughout the presentation to answer questions as we move through. So don't think you have to wait until the end. We'll pause and I'll make sure everybody understands there's a time to ask questions as we move forward through the presentation. So just a little about who Longview is from a Microsoft partner perspective. So we've been a partner of Microsoft since 2004. Really, we're gold certified across most of the Microsoft ecosystem. We're one of the rare organizations, or the only organization actually worldwide, who's won Partner of the Year 2 years in a row. That was in 2018 and 2019. We're really hoping for a three-peat this year and are very proud of our work in partnership with Microsoft. And we have over 600 certified individuals across different Microsoft, let's call it competencies, which is a bigger bench than Microsoft has from a Canadian perspective, with resources and available resources to support your initiatives and for us to work with you across healthcare. So really our vision here at Longview and in partnership with Microsoft is to enable organizations to work productively and securely. And this is really anywhere, anytime, any device and any content, in a way that you haven't been able to do before. So it's fully interactive. It gives you capabilities you didn't have before, whether that's within your organization, that's external to the organization, or again, how you engage your customers. And that would be things like a clinician to a patient, and telehealth as an example. And really running your business on Microsoft Teams. Teams is becoming a hub for everything you do in your day. So not bouncing around before from tool to tool and one application to another and one system to another. It's really one hub for teamwork, one hub for unified communications, collaboration, and productivity, where you can drive projects, processes. It's very interactive from a people perspective and the ability for people to meet both voice, video, immersive chat, and persistent chat across the organization. This is just a brief review and kind of an overview of all the capabilities within Microsoft Teams. I'm going to move from this slide very shortly into the actual Teams client, so you're able to see the things that I'm talking about kind of live and in action without a slide. I'll drive this slide forward a little bit and just review for everybody. It's a hub for teamwork. Yes, what does that mean? It means you've got all kinds of capabilities from a unified communications, collaboration perspective, productivity perspective. It's secure because it has inherent security from Microsoft 365 and O365 security. But your basics are you've got your chat, which you can see in the background on the screen right now. It's just showing an example of persistent chats, whether that's between peer-to-peer, whether that's a group, whether that's in a Teams site or a Teams channel. Really, it's persistent chat that carries across all your devices and gives you the same experience, whether you're at a desktop, whether you're on a laptop and you're mobile, whether you're on a tablet, as an example, or your smartphone. Meetings, fully interactive meetings with voice, video. You've got the ability to have persistent chat and share documentation while you're in these meetings. You have the ability to leverage an application like Microsoft Whiteboard, where the team can whiteboard and save what goes on a whiteboard in real time. Everybody can interact, everybody can have their input. It's very unique and very modern in the way that you can handle meetings now, especially in this current time of COVID-19 and pandemic, with not only remote, but once we return back to facilities and everybody gets back into the work environments, it's that same experience that you had remote that you'll have in meeting rooms, and the ability to do the same thing and the same client experience, which is important to all of us. You've got voice capabilities, so this is internal calls or external if your organization decides to enable enterprise voice within your M365 and Microsoft Teams environment. You've got capability to share files, to collaborate on files in real time, whether that's SharePoint integration or OneDrive integration into your Teams environment, which is what it leverages, the client leverages to be able to do so. So that's all Office apps are fully integrated as well. And the last piece we'll talk about is apps and workflows. That's really adding third-party applications like Planner. So you almost have a project manager application where it keeps teams coordinating on projects or executing on specific initiatives, and everybody has timelines and due dates, and it keeps everybody making sure that they're highly productive on those aspects. Or it's adding dashboards and information, and I'll talk about those examples from a healthcare perspective just shortly in the presentation. So if you bear with me, I'm going to move out here and move to a different screen. Again, chat, this is all the current chat threads that I have. Think of it as current history. Anything new that comes in, it'll be highlighted. Right now I have a do not disturb on, so it's not going to notify me or put a notification up to in front of everybody to disturb what's going on. We've got Teams. This is all the teams I belong to. Within Teams, you have channels. This specific team I'm in right now, we call it our Microsoft technology channel and team sessions. And within this channel, I have posts. That's just really inline chat and persistent chat within that team and channel. I've got different files that are incorporated that I can present and share with individuals real time. I've got real time information like Power BI, where I can bring through a dashboard that shows me all of the important information I need to be connected to. So in healthcare, if this was an individual who needs to be mindful of supply chain and resourcing across a facility, they could have a dashboard like this within a team that shows them all the information, how many ventilators they have, how many masks, those kinds of things on hand. We'll also get into things like I called out Planner. And Planner is really almost like a PM for us to ensure that everybody is following through on activities that they need to. I can assign those tasks to individuals like I have Raj. I can make sure that everybody understands what the due date is. They can update me on progress, all of those great things. You've got full calendar integration, and this is with Exchange. So a lot of people will go into their email and their Outlook and navigate their calendar. I never use Outlook for my calendar anymore. I'm strictly in Microsoft Teams. Exchange is fully integrated into Teams with Office apps. So you have one hub where you can do everything in a very fluid and productive manner. It's easy to set up meetings, check people's schedule. As an example, I can put the title of the meeting, add the individuals who are required, the time, all those good things. Talked about calling. Calling, it's internal calls or external if you have enterprise voice enabled. I've got speed dial set up. I've got all the contacts that I have within my Outlook contacts. I've got history of recent calls and my voicemail, all the things you're used to in your day-to-day. And this could be soft phone based from the laptop, which I'm on right now. I can use the same enterprise voice capabilities off a mobile device. I can use it off a tablet, or I could have desk sets, front-end phones, team certified devices connected in meeting rooms to give me the same experience across all devices. I like to show this slide. It really highlights what I talked about before. It's really Teams as a hub for everything you do now. Once Exchange and email is fully integrated, which is coming, you won't need to leave this hub for everything you do productively in a day, all of your communication needs, all of your collaboration needs. And it is a presentation layer that you can customize because there's all kinds of things that you can integrate into the Teams client to really drive a unique experience of what you're capable to do for job role and function. So within healthcare, you have, whether it's surgeons, nurses, individuals in maintenance, individuals in resourcing, individuals responsible for maintenance of the bedding and different things that go on in the hospitals, they can all have a customized view and setup of what they require from the Teams client instead of just the generic what we went through before, some of the native ways that you can leverage Teams. They can really harness the power in a way that's meaningful for them. And the organization can provide a whole bunch of business outcomes for job roles and functions within healthcare in a meaningful way. This is across all devices. So this is important today from an end user experience perspective. We all know we like things to be consistent. We like things to be the same experience, whether I'm at my desk, whether I'm on a mobile device, or now a unique way to interact with your clients, or let's call it patients, or those external to the organization. They don't have to have Microsoft Teams and Microsoft Teams desktop app or a mobile app. You can invite them to have an engagement and a full experience, interactive experience with you from a web client. As long as they have access to a web client, we'll highlight this in virtual visits, which is really telehealth. We'll highlight this and show you an example of this and how it works. You have the ability to fully secure and ensure privacy is in place when you're extending out with interaction of your customers or really your patients and those you're providing care to. I want to talk a little bit about artificial intelligence and how that's embedded into Microsoft Teams and the Teams platform. It helps us do things that we couldn't do before in a very unique way, in a very interactive way, and a very inclusive way. And this to me is extremely important. And I'll highlight about two or three key capabilities within AI and Microsoft Teams that have really changed the game, not only for me and for our organization, but for many organizations who are leveraging the platform today. So inline message translation, I can now interact with people who do not speak the same language I do, or multiple different individuals who could be in different geographies around the world. And through inline message translation, we can understand what each other is saying in a fully interactive chat and real-time chat scenario. When you talk about inclusion in the workplace today, or if you want to engage individuals from a telehealth perspective, live captions and subtitles become very important. I now have the ability through live captions and subtitles for those who have hearing impairment to be fully engaged in a meeting or fully engaged in a video and online chat situation like never before. Or if I have people who are visually impaired, they will have the whole audio experience. So they'll get the full voice experience and can fully provide input and fully be part of that situation and that interactive, immersive type of interaction that's required. And then the last one I'll talk about on the far right-hand side is these customized backgrounds. So today we're all working remote, or many people are working remote. Even those who are in facilities and healthcare facilities today, there's a lot of activity going on in the background. And you can blur the background, or you can put customized backgrounds up like you saw I had prior earlier when I had my video on. You can eliminate distractions behind you and have real focused conversations with individuals or meetings in a way you couldn't before. You would see in a flexible workspace, as an example, people behind you or in a hospital, you would see all kinds of activity behind you. So these are all really fantastic innovations that help from a user experience perspective in a way that we couldn't do before. I want to dive into now examples and art of the possible and what's going on in healthcare and how are people leveraging Microsoft Teams. So today I'm not going to focus on the technical aspects as much as I will more. What are the business outcomes that you can drive? How can you extend healthcare through Microsoft Teams? So scenarios like coordinating patient care in one hub. So that's communicate patient updates in real time, collaborate across the organization, multiple individuals who need to be involved and understand what's going on with that patient situation and the care of that patient. So this was very difficult to do before. It's something now, I'll give you an example of this patient care coordination from somebody coming in from emergency services and they've got a patient in an ambulance, somebody's been injured. They can now communicate with those individuals who are going to handle that individual's care when they arrive at the hospital on the facility to emergency, and they can see what they're going to deal with when they get there. They can also see if they need to bring in an additional specialist that the situation is going to warrant that they wouldn't have known prior to them getting there. And that's something that the individuals, as well as the emergency technicians, have the ability to communicate on Teams with those individuals who they're going to meet at emergency when they arrive. Crisis communication. So these are things where Microsoft has enabled Power Apps, and I won't get too much into Power Platform and different aspects of how you can integrate a whole bunch of power into driving business process and workflow for specific outcomes within healthcare and your organization. So during a crisis like current COVID-19 and pandemic situation, it helps organizations coordinate information, share information, collaborate as a team, and collect data about the safety of employees, as an example. Or admins can publish updates in a real-time feed for emergency contacts for different locations, or employees can report work status. You can make sure that the individuals who need to receive it, whether it's leadership within a healthcare organization or whether it's everyone working on the front line, gets the latest updates from the World Health Organization and CDC, as an example. During the initial COVID-19 pandemic, when it struck, there was obviously a flood to service desks and help desks and a flood of calls coming in to your organizations that really took your frontline workers and took your care workers away from focusing on the care of individuals in front of them or in your facilities at the time. And what you see here is Microsoft has developed a bot where you can pull all kinds of information into the bot through artificial intelligence and now have a means for people in a real-time conversation to access healthcare information, get answers to questions without having to wait on hold for a long period of time or not be able to get through for a long period of time, or you're not distracting individuals on the front line who need to respond to live situations, freeze them up, like your doctors, your nurses, administrators, to provide the actual care and not answer some questions that are coming in. Very unique service. There's several who have adopted this across different hospitals in North America to really lessen the burden on their organization from that help desk contact center type scenario, or people having to step in on the front line and answer questions for people phoning in, asking different questions about related symptoms or different things they had and wondering if they should come in or not come in to get care. Healthcare emergency resource tracking or response resource tracking. Seattle Hospital, others have adopted this. What they've done is they've built, again, an application that they fully integrated into Teams for those individuals who are looking after management of supplies across the organization. How many beds are available? How many masks? How many ventilators? They've got dashboards to make quick resourcing decisions and quicker time than they ever did before in order to be highly productive, responsive across their organization. This is something that was very fragmented before, and where you got your information and how you got the information, and then the ability for people to make decisions instead of real time. Everybody sees the dashboards, everybody understands, they can quickly, either through chat or voice, get a hold of each other and make decisions, or jump into an online meeting quickly to collaborate as a group and make those decisions quickly. So virtual visits is virtual consults or telehealth. Many organizations, and we talk about a reference client that we've dealt with in the healthcare sector who wasn't telehealth enabled before or didn't have the ability to support virtual visits. They were an organization who supported care for many mental health patients, and without this capability, it could have been a very negative impact. Enabling them to be able to do this through Microsoft Teams was a huge, huge success for them and a new way for them to provide care in a way they never were able to before, as well as communicate, collaborate, and be productive across their organization. So I'm going to jump into a video right now.
App in Microsoft Teams is a powerful new tool that enables virtual visits for healthcare and streamlined scheduling tasks. With bookings in Teams, the scheduler can see multiple clinicians' Outlook calendars, so it's easy to create appointments and manage complex scheduling demands. Use the drop-down menu to select the appointment type. Patient information, appointment details, internal notes, and links to documents can be included as needed in the clinician's invitation. Customized appointment confirmations and reminders are automatically sent to the patient while maintaining the privacy of the sender's email address. With bookings, clinics can also offer patients the options to see available appointment times and schedule their own virtual visit. Patients can easily join their virtual appointment via a web browser or mobile app with a single click or touch. With bookings in Teams, providers can enable a virtual lobby for patients to wait before being admitted to the visit. And clinicians can make use of all the great meeting features in Microsoft Teams, including high-quality video and audio, custom backgrounds, and cloud recording. The Bookings app empowers clinicians to offer secure virtual appointments with Microsoft Teams.
All right, I'm going to move through to one more video. Again, this just starts to paint more of the art of possible picture on what other organizations are doing with Microsoft Teams, your capabilities through Microsoft Teams. And I think it's important to add further context to the conversation we've been having today throughout this session and really provide a platform for you to have ideas on how your organization could possibly start to implement and adopt Microsoft Teams.
In healthcare, connections is everything. The ability to reach and communicate with your team members, the ability to have shared consciousness around the patient's care and the care plan, that's actually how better care is achieved.
Patient safety and patient quality is a huge focus for all of us in healthcare, engaging all members of the team and moving away from this old concept of really siloed care is imperative in order to improve patient outcomes. Northwell is always trying to bring innovative technology to the forefront. It allows us to communicate with all team members real time. We can make sure that nothing gets missed.
Microsoft Teams is our platform for secure messaging and communication.
We're able to communicate and add people to the team regardless of where the patient is in that throughput of care. I can add everyone together, give them a plan, and we can move forward from there. It allows everyone to be on the same page, especially when there's multiple subspecialties involved. It's also allowed for real-time conversation while the patients are being transported. Previously, that was a black hole. We had no idea what was happening.
It allowed that moment-to-moment notice and point-to-point communication and was in compliance with those levels of privacy that we would want as clinicians.
Teams has shifted the way we've worked by allowing us to text with confidentiality, to communicate directly with much less concern. We can get information from one another in a very rapid fashion, but that's not intrusive. It's really made our lives so much easier.
Microsoft Teams has been really beneficial in reaching my goals for patient care because I'm able to really stay on top of my patients.
Having people on the same page, communicating, and jointly planning care is absolutely vital in this day and age. Of all the technologies that we've implemented in the last 10 years, Teams is the most transformative of all.
I'm really excited about ways that we can use this technology to make physicians' jobs easier, to make it easier for them to provide better patient care.
I'm excited, I'm proud. It's so amazing to be on the cutting edge.
One thing I want to move into now is it's one thing to deploy and adopt this technology. There's all kinds of transformation that goes along with this. It's a lot of change for your people, a lot of change across the organization. So what are some key lessons learned from our experience in deploying, you know, thousands and thousands of users and hundreds of organizations now on Microsoft Teams, whether that was rapid deployment due to the COVID-19 impact or more methodical planned approaches by organizations? There's a common thread and things that you need to be aware of before you deploy Microsoft Teams so that it's adopted and drives true value for your organization. So we really break this into three aspects for you. There's people, process, technology, where some of the bigger impacts, if you don't handle these properly, adoption of Teams and success with Microsoft Teams and return on investment will not be a success for your organization. So I'll start with the people side of it. So first of all, like I said, there's a lot of change when it comes to how people work today versus how they will work and the capability for them to work moving forward from a platform and a client like Microsoft Teams. So your adoption change management program, ensuring that you have that sound, including end user training. You've got different personas identified across your organization and their needs with the platform and the client. You want to make sure you're enabling targeted pilots at specific groups early on where there's less risk and where you can make sure that if there's any gaps in your adoption and change management program, including training, that those are closed before you roll out across the entire organization from a production perspective. And you want to make sure that your communications and the ability for people to understand what's coming, see videos, get at artifacts, get at some training prior to the actual rollout across the organization is important. The second piece we'll talk about is process, and then the processes around operationalizing this and understanding at the front end, day one governance needs to be in place. A lot of organizations, if they've just deployed Microsoft Teams and didn't have their governance framework, which consists of seven key pillars, in place from day one, it can turn into Wild West, can turn into something that's very hard to corral and pull back. Your governance program is something that will be iterative over time as well. And based on your maturity, as you start to get more mature in the adoption and how you use Microsoft Teams, it's important that you continue to iterate that governance model, and not all groups will have the same governance model or framework from one group to the next based on their job role and function within the organization. Governance leads itself into security. Security is very, very critical. So is privacy in a highly regulated industry like healthcare. And you want to make sure that you have security in place, the right controls, the right setup from a technical perspective prior to going live. And you're going to need to optimize this and harden this over time. As we know, there was all kinds of issues in the news with new cyber attacks and threats that happened at a unforeseen rate before due to COVID-19. And we're still seeing that today. So it's something that needs to be in place, and it needs to be hardened and again optimized over time. And the last piece is kind of that technology side. So as organizations start to move back and bring people back into facilities, you know, as long as you have decent internet connection, Teams is optimized to work from a remote perspective. But as we come back into our facilities, making sure your network is A, configured the right way, because it's different how you set up your network from a Office 365 and Microsoft Teams perspective than it was how you had some of your systems and configurations in your network set up before to deal with different types of technology and mainly on-prem and different connectivity. So you want to make sure you've got that readiness in place. You want to make sure that if you're doing things like virtual desktop enablement to individuals for remote work or for security reasons, that again, your network can support that experience and a good end user experience. I'm going to pause for a second. Raj, is there any questions?
You know, you've talked about adoption, and this attendee writes, well, what learnings can you share about adopting MS Teams in healthcare?
Adoption change management, the training is critical. Those are two key things from an adoption perspective, and phasing that adoption across the organization and not trying to have adoption carte blanche across the organization. You need to phase it in, and you need to pick the spots where it's most meaningful for the organization to start to roll out Microsoft Teams and who's going to benefit the most, and then phase it in across the entire organization. So you're getting the greatest impact early on and the greatest success from an adoption perspective. The other thing I will tell you is you need to make sure you have that top-down support in healthcare organizations. And those individuals are people who are in the early adoption phase so that they're really communicating and backing the organization in that direction and providing that support and influence across the organization as you roll out. The other piece is obviously on the governance and security side. That needs to be solid.
Okay, very good. So Shane, just to recap, you're saying that a phased approach to adoption or rollout is important. And then also, because it's an organizational change or an organizational wide change and transformation, you really do need executive support and buy-in for successful Teams implementation.
Exactly, Raj. If you don't have that, you won't have the type of success you want, nor will you get the greatest return on investment and really start to leverage Teams to drive those kinds of outcomes that you don't have the capability for today without it.
Okay. Do we have time for one more question? Or
we do. I'll answer another one before I move forward. You bet.
How secure is Microsoft Teams?
So Microsoft Teams itself is as secure as your Office 365 deployment. So Microsoft Teams inherently in Office 365 is very secure from a certain perspective, but if you do not harden that security and you do not have things in place for, let's call it remote workers today, like two-factor authentication and different aspects of your security and governance practices in place, then you'll have more risk. But there's ways to really secure within your Office 365 deployment and your Teams deployment to really minimize that risk. But again, there's a combination of things that come into play there. and HIPAA compliance and other pieces where you're receiving these services from a Microsoft perspective, that's in place. But what you're doing is extending services out and out to the edge right now, remote or with people in your facilities, and your security has to be in place to handle those things as well. So it's as secure as you're going to harden it. And just having the standard settings in Office 365 and Teams isn't going to cut it from a security perspective or a privacy perspective.
To successfully deploy it from a security perspective, it has to be part of a successful or a secure Office 365 deployment. So it's not something you separate from Office 365. It's got to be part of an overall strategy. But, you know, again, I know that you've been involved with many of those implementations. So, you know, determining and implementing and managing security for Office 365 is definitely doable. And I know you've done it in many different locations. So that's good to know. So hopefully that answers that question.
I'll give you another example, Raj. People, if they're not aware and they're not trained and understand that you can collaborate on documents and share documents within Microsoft Teams itself without going outside or emailing it back and forth, which becomes higher risk security-wise. And you can make edits and everyone can see who's made edits, but it's very secure within the Teams client itself. It's other behaviors in organizations, if they don't realize they have that capability, that again start to add to the risk. And to mitigate that risk, you have to have other security measures in place. And information protection is another critical thing. And that's not standard settings out of the box. We need to work with clients on what controls to set in place, as well as what governance controls to set in place and what framework around Teams in order to minimize that risk and make it not a people problem. The organization's made it easy to use, but they've got the right security and governance posture in place to minimize risks.
Shane, that's a really good point. And I think really what you're saying is that if you do implement Office 365 or features of it, and you just spin it up as is, you really do need to think through the standard settings that they have. They may not be appropriate for your environment.
Yeah, and in many cases, you know, that's not geared towards how certain individuals or lines of business are going to work within healthcare organizations. And certain individuals have patient information and patient records and different things, and that information needs to be shared in a very secure way. And if they understand how to do that within the actual Teams client itself, and they don't need to step outside of that or email it back and forth, as an example, in a personal email, or download that natively to a device and then reshare it out, you really start to limit that risk. And there's ways to control that in an automated way so that people don't have the ability to do it, but they've got notifications as to why they can't do it and how they need to do it. Raj and I wanted to really highlight one specific reference of a large healthcare group. They're based in Toronto and out in Ontario. This was an organization who wasn't set up to provide a good remote work capability, and B, they weren't able to provide telehealth and healthcare to the individuals they needed to in that remote way. So their answer was to come to us and say, we need help. We need help enabling and deploying this rapidly and quickly. We talked to them about, okay, we have a framework for this. We understand how to do it. But you need to understand, we can get this deployed and get people access to the tool and to the client and to the platform quickly. But here's kind of the key foundation of things that we're going to do to make sure we optimize and harden this once we push it out to people so that they get the right adoption, you're getting the right return on investment, it's secure, you have the right privacy in place, and people can work and provide healthcare in a very productive and interactive way like they never could before, and communicate both internally and externally in a way they never could before, and collaborate. What we did is we did a rapid deployment for them of up to 7,000 users in 3 days on Teams, drove that up to 12,000 users in 5 days. We had adoption change management foundations in place at the beginning of this, and we're training people as we rolled them out, including individuals within healthcare organizations who control other people's schedules or bookings, and they needed to understand how to do that on behalf of other individuals in the organization. Executive assistants are one example, but also those who are in charge or manage different groups of healthcare professionals within an organization. We made sure they had a governance day one plan in place. We hardened that as we started to get greater and greater adoption. We hardened their security for them. we made sure that not only end users, but from a system admin perspective and operationalizing this across their help desk, that was in place so they could support people, make sure that it's one thing to have people know how to use it, but if they have an issue, they need support and they need to make sure they're supported in the right ways. So what we've done with this organization is we continue to work with them. Once we got it rolled out from a remote perspective, we then started to work with them on, okay, what happens when we return to our facilities and what happens when we return to work? And we were starting to help them now on that network side and optimizing their network capabilities, making sure that from a virtual desktop perspective, that they're leveraging their investment in Citrix to enable Teams to those who need it on a virtual desktop, and that they have full access to provide telehealth and different things from that Teams client. So I'll pause here. Raj, is there any additional questions that have come in regards to this or other questions that you'd like me to answer?
You know, what are the primary, like let's say the top three governance considerations that you need to keep in mind when you're successfully rolling out MS Teams? And I think it's interesting. I think you've kind of got much of that captured in this current slide, but I'm just wondering if you can talk to that, Shane. They just want to know from a governance perspective, like we talked to it here, but really, what are the top three priorities and, you know, and just how important are they?
So you've got seven key pillars, and these key pillars in your governance framework from day one, you need to make sure that you've got naming conventions for your teams set up in a way that makes sense organizationally for internal teams. You will need to have different naming convention for external teams. You need to make the decisions on who can set up teams in the organization. Is there a process where you're going to involve service desk through to approval and then teams set up by a group on behalf of the organization? Or are you going to empower people to do that or empower lines of business to do that? You're going to want to make sure that you have the decisions made on how you're auditing teams and how you're archiving teams that no longer need to be active. You're going to want to make sure you understand you're monitoring those teams to understand the use of the teams, how much information sits in those teams from a data perspective. Those are some of your key pillars, and there's really seven of them, and then there's subsets underneath those, and we walk organizations through those. And I'm happy to send out what those seven pillars are to everyone who's attended today, because it's so important when you move forward with adoption and deployment of Microsoft Teams. If you have that day one governance and framework in place, you'll have a lot of success moving forward as an organization. You don't have to corral a lot of what we like to call Wild West, because we've been brought in to clean up a lot of the Wild West because there was no governance up front with organizations as well. And it's a tough thing to pull it back.
Right. And you know what, Shane, first off, appreciate that, because you and I have spoken to a variety of hospitals in Ontario who've said, hey, look, we're using MS Teams. It is terrific. But you know what? We really could use some guidance in terms of, you know, what are the best practices to actually scale this without having to go back and do a redo. So, again, having a governance approach is pretty critical.
Yeah. And the one other piece of advice I would give to everyone is to make sure you understand it's iterative. You need to make sure that the governance framework, there'll be an overarching framework for the organization, but there'll be different requirements within your governance model for specific line of businesses or different groups of users. And there's specific reasons for that and why you would do that. But that's another piece of advice I'd give everybody, is you have to think of that as iterative and it'll change over time. I wanted to just talk about, we're here to help. We want to help all of you with your initiatives around Microsoft Teams or other Microsoft initiatives that integrate with your Microsoft Teams initiatives. We've got all kinds of capability here, from your design architecture services through to deployment adoption services, including adoption change management, governance, and the training pieces, all the way through to if you need operational support through managed services to augment your teams. This technology is newer. There's many different aspects to it. And I talked before that one slide I showed, there's a lot of underpinning that goes on with Microsoft Teams and a lot of integration from third-party apps to SharePoint, OneDrive, Stream, all the different things that move into the Teams platform, the great thing is it's one consolidated place for everybody to work from and be highly productive on behalf of their organization, but you do have a lot of considerations with what you're trying to manage and support there. And I'll open it up for questions now.
All right. Well, you know what, Shane, I think we got through most of the questions. We got one final one, which is interesting. What's involved with a pilot for Microsoft Teams? Can you do one? And what do you need from us? And that's largely from a small hospital that's asking if we're going to do a pilot or if they're interested in a pilot, what can we do for them? And what do they need to, what do we need from them?
Yeah, so typically before we'll execute on a pilot, we'll come in and we'll do a workshop format with you to understand. There's two components to the workshop. One is what we call a business decision makers workshop, where we understand what are some of, let's call it 1 to 3 key motivations and business drivers for wanting to deploy Teams, and what are you looking for from a business outcome perspective. And then we'll get into a workshop around framing the actual pilot and what's the success criteria. Here's some of the day one governance. Here's some of the adoption change management. Here's the different pieces. And we'll run that pilot like we were rolling it out to production to ensure that you're going to see the real value from it. And we want to make sure that how we gauge this is you are receiving value from that pilot.
Very good. Well, Shane, let me just see here. I'm just going to check the queue. I think we've got through most of the queue. You know, at this point, what I wanted to do first off was to thank you. Thank you for the presentation. Thank you for taking us through it. I'd also like to thank everyone for joining us. Without anything further, Shane, I'm going to just turn it over to you for a quick final remark, and then we'll sum up.
Echo your comments, Raj. Thank you, everyone, for attending today. We want to make sure everybody understands that Microsoft Teams is more than just a unified communications collaboration platform. It's actually a presentation layer to engage with your customers and your patients in a different way than you ever have before. It can be customized for just specific job role and functions. Yeah, at the core of it, it unifies communications, collaboration, and productivity. But really what you can do with it from there is limitless. And we showed some of the art of possible today. So I would just encourage everyone to reach out and get support with where you want to go with it, because it's all about getting true value out of the technology, not just deploying it for the sake of having a chat and meetings and collaboration tool. It's a lot more than that.
Very good.
So I would just end on that, Raj.
Well, very good. Shane, thank you. And I'd like to thank everyone for joining. We're going to wrap up the webinar. And we look forward to talking to you again soon.